Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Suicide House by Charlie Donlea. Narrated by Vivienne Leheny. Session 1. Journal Entry. The Tracks. I killed my brother with a penny. Simple, benign, and perfectly believable. It happened at the tracks, because, as life would teach me in the years to come, a speeding train was many things. Majestic, when it blurred past too quickly for the eyes to register anything but streaks of color. Powerful, when it rumbled underfoot like an impending earthquake. Deafening, when it roared along the rails like a thunderstorm dropped from the heavens. A speeding train was all these things, and more. A speeding train was deadly. The gravel leading up to the tracks was loosely packed, and our feet slipped as we climbed. It was evening, close to 6 o'clock, the usual time the train rolled through town. The bottoms of the clouds blushed with a dying crimson as the sun settled under the horizon. Dusk was the best time to visit the tracks. In broad daylight, the conductor might spot us and call the police to report two kids playing dangerously close to the tracks. Of course, I made sure that scenario had already happened. It was essential to my plan. Had I killed my brother the very first time I brought him here, my anonymity in this tragedy would have been paper thin. I needed ammunition for when the police came to question me. I needed to create an irrefutable history about our time at the tracks. We'd been here before. We'd been seen. We'd been caught. Our parents had been informed, and we had been punished. A pattern had been developed. But this time, I would tell them, things had gone wrong. We were kids. We were stupid. The narrative was flawless, and I would later learn that it needed to be. The detective who would look into my brother's death was an onerous force. Immediately suspicious of my story, he was never truly satisfied with my explanation of events. To this day, I am certain he is not. But my version of that day and the history I had created was watertight. Despite his efforts, the detective found no holes. Once we made it to the top of the embankment and stood next to the tracks, I fished two pennies from my pocket and handed one to my brother. They were shiny and unblemished, but would soon be thin and smooth after we placed them on the rails for the roaring train to flatten them. Dropping pennies onto the tracks was an exciting event for my brother, who had never heard of such a thing before I introduced him to the concept. Dozens of other flattened pennies filled a bowl in my bedroom. I needed them. When the police came to ask their questions, the collection of pennies would serve as proof that we'd done this before. Far out in the evening, I heard the whistle. The faint sound seemed to catch in the clouds above us, echoing in the bloodshot cotton balls. The evening was darker now as the sun melted away, grainy and opalescent, just the right mixture of dusk for us to see what we were doing, but not enough to betray our presence. I crouched down and placed my penny on the tracks. My brother did the same. We waited. The first few times we'd come here, we placed our pennies on the rails and ran back down the embankment to hide in the shadows. But soon we discovered that in the evening, no one noticed us. With each venture back to the tracks, we stopped running when the train approached. In fact, we crept closer. What was it about being so close to danger that filled us with adrenaline? My brother had no idea. I was quite certain. With each successive trip, he became easier to manipulate. For a moment, it felt unfair, as if I had stepped into the role of bully, a role my brother had mastered. But I reminded myself not to confuse efficiency with simplicity. This felt easy only because of my diligence. It felt easy only because I had made it that way. The train's headlights came into view as it approached, first the top light, and soon after the two ditch lights. I crept closer to the rails. He was next to me to my right. I had to look past him to see the train's approach. He was aware of me, I could tell, because when I crept closer to the tracks, he matched my movements. He didn't want to miss out. He didn't want to allow me more bragging rights or a greater surge of adrenaline. He couldn't allow me to have anything that he could claim as his own. It was how he was. It was how all bullies were. The train was nearly upon us. "You're Penny," I said. "What?" my brother asked. "You're Penny. It's not in the right spot." He looked down, leaning slightly over the tracks. The roaring train barreled toward us. I took a step back and pushed him. It was over in an instant. He was there 1 second and gone the next. The train roared past, filling my ears with thunder and turning my vision into a blur of rusted colors. The train produced a current of air that pulled me a step or two to my left and sucked me forward, willing me to join my brother. I braced my feet in the gravel to resist the tug. When the last car passed, the invisible grip released me. I staggered backward. My vision returned, and quiet filled my ears. When I looked down at the tracks, the only thing left of my brother was his right shoe, strangely standing upright, as if he'd slipped it off his foot and laid it on the rails. I was careful to leave the shoe untouched. I picked up my penny, though. It was flat and thin and wide. I dropped it in my pocket and headed home to add it to my collection and to tell my parents the terrible news. I closed the leather-bound journal. A long tassel hung from the bottom, keeping my place for the next time I read from it during a session. The room was dead quiet. "Are you shocked?" I finally asked. The woman across from me shook her head. Her demeanor had not changed during my confession.
"Not at all."
"Good. I came here for therapy, not judgment." I lifted the journal. "I'd like to tell you about the others." I waited. The woman stared at me. "There are more. I didn't stop with my brother." I paused again. The woman continued to stare at me. "Would you mind if I told you about the others?" She shook her head again.
"Not at all."
I nodded my head. "Excellent. Then I will." Westmont Preparatory High School, Friday, June 21st, 2019, 11:54 p.m. A fingernail moon floated in the midnight sky, its tarnished sheen intermittently visible through the foliage. The moon's erratic presence penetrated the interlocking tree branches with a pale glaze that painted the forest floor in the lacquered finish of a black and white film. Visibility came from the candle he carried, the flame of which died every time he picked up his pace and tried to jog through the woods. He tried to slow himself, to be careful and deliberate. But walking was not an option. He needed to hurry. He needed to be the first to arrive. He needed to beat the others. He cupped his hand in front of the candle to protect the flame, which allowed him a few uninterrupted minutes to scan the forest. He walked for a few yards until he came to a row of suspicious-looking trees. As he stood perfectly still and scanned the tree trunks, looking for the key he so desperately needed, the candle's flame expired. There was no wind. The flame simply died, leaving a plume of smoke that filled his nostrils with the scent of burnt wax. The sudden and unexplained eclipse of the candle meant the man in the mirror was close. By rules no one ever broke, He had 10 seconds to relight the candle. Fumbling with the matches, the rules allowed only matches, no lighters, he struck a matchstick across the phosphorus strip on the side of the box. Nothing. His hand shook as he swiped again. The match broke in half and fell to the dark forest floor. He reached into the matchbox, spilling several others in the process. "Damn it," he whispered. He couldn't afford to waste matches. He'd need them again if he made it back to the house and into the safe room. But right now, he was alone in the dark woods with an unlit candle and in great danger, if he believed the rumors and folklore. The tremors that gripped his body suggested he did. He steadied his hand, just long enough to make a smooth sweep against the phosphorus, which caused the match to light in a sizzling blaze. The eruption gave off a cloud of sulfur-tinged smoke before calming to a controlled flame. He touched the match to the candle's wick, happy for the light it provided. He calmed his breathing and watched the shadowed forest around him. He listened and waited. And when he was sure he had beaten the clock, he returned his attention to the row of trees before him. Slowly, he made his way forward, carefully shielding the flame as he went. A lighted candle was the only way to keep the man in the mirror away. He made it to the huge black oak tree and saw a wooden box at its base. He fell to his knees and opened the lid. A key rested inside. His heart pounded with powerful contractions that rushed blood through the bulging vessels in his neck. He took a deep, calming breath and then blew out the candle. Rules stated that guidance candles could stay lighted only until a key was found. He took off through the woods. In the distance, a train whistle blew into the night, fueling his adrenaline. The race was on. He crashed through the forest, twisting an ankle and unsuccessfully shielding his face from the branches that whipped his cheeks. As he continued through the woods, the rumble of the train shook the ground beneath him as it roared past. The vibration brought more urgency to his steps. When he reached the edge of the forest, the train was charging along the tracks to his left in a metallic blur that erratically caught the reflection of the moon. He broke free from the dark foliage and took off toward the house, his grunting and panting overtaken by the roar of the train. He made it to the door and pushed inside. "Congratulations," a voice said to him as soon as he was through the door. "You're the first one." "Sweet," he said, out of breath. "Did you find the key?" He held it up. "Yeah." "Follow me." They crept through the black hallways of the house until they came to the door of the safe room. He inserted the key into the doorknob and twisted. The lock surrendered, and the door swung open. They entered, and then closed the door behind them. The room was pitch black, much worse than what the forest had offered. "Hurry." He fell to the floor, and on his hands and knees felt along the hard wood until his fingers came to the row of candles that sat in front of a tall standing mirror. He reached into his pocket and pulled out the book of matches. There were 3 remaining. He struck a matchstick along the edge of the box and the tip ignited. He lit one of the candles and stood to face the mirror, which was covered by a heavy tarp. He took a deep breath and nodded to the one who had met him at the door. Together, they pulled the tarp from the mirror. His reflection was shadowed by candlelight, but he noticed the horizontal lacerations that cut across his cheek and the blood that streamed down from them. He looked eerie and battle-worn, but he'd made it. The rumbling evaporated as the last train car passed the house and continued off to the east. Silence filled the room. Looking in the mirror, he took one last breath. Then, together, they whispered, "The man in the mirror, the man in the mirror, the man in the mirror." A moment passed, during which neither blinked or breathed. Then something flashed behind them, a blur in the mirror between their reflections. Then a face materialized from the darkness and came into focus, a pair of eyes bright with ricochets from the candle's flame. Before either could turn or scream or fight, the candle's flame went out. Peppermill, Indiana, Saturday, June 22, 2019, 3:33 a.m. The detective steered his car past the yellow crime scene tape, already securing the perimeter, and pulled into the chaos of red and blue lights. Squad cars, ambulances, and fire trucks were parked at odd angles in front of the brick pillars that marked the entrance to Westmont Preparatory High School, a private boarding school. What a goddamn mess. His commanding officer had been short on details, other than that a couple of kids had been killed out in the woods at the edge of campus. The situation was ripe for overreaction, hence the presence of the town's entire police and fire departments, and from the look of it, half the hospital staff. Doctors in scrubs and nurses in white coats glowed as they walked in front of the ambulance headlights. Officers talked to students and faculty as they poured through the front gates and into the circus of flashing lights. He noticed a Channel 6 news van parked outside the crime scene tape. Despite the bewitching hour, he was sure more were on the way. Detective Henry Ott climbed from his car while the officer in charge brought him up to speed.
The first 911 call came in at 12:25. Several others followed, all describing some sort of mess out in the woods.
Where? Ott asked.
At an abandoned house on the edge of campus.
Abandoned?
From what we've learned so far, the officer said, it used to be a boarding house for faculty, but it's been empty for several years since a Canadian National Rail line went up that sent daily freight trains past that part of campus. It was too loud, so new faculty housing was built on the main campus. The school had plans to develop the land into a football field and track and field course, but for now the house just sits abandoned in the woods. We talked to a few students. Sounds like it was a favorite hangout for late-night parties.
Detective Ott walked toward the gates of Westmont Prep and then through the entrance. A golf cart sat parked in front of the school's main building. Four giant pillars rose up to support the large triangular gable that glowed under the spotlights. The school's logo was engraved across the surface of the stone.
"Veniam solum reliquitus et," Detective Ott said, his head craned back as he looked up at the building.
"Arrive alone, leave together."
"What's that mean?"
Detective Ott looked back at the officer.
"I don't really give a shit. Where are we headed?"
"Climb in,"
the officer said, pointing at the golf cart.
"The house is on the outskirts of campus, about a 20-minute walk through the woods. This'll be faster."
The detective clambered into the golf cart, and a few minutes later he was bouncing through the woods on a narrow dirt path. The trunks of tall birch trees were a blur in his peripheral vision. The light from the moon was gone, and as they drove deeper into the woods, only the golf cart's headlights offered any glimpse of where they were headed.
"Jesus Christ," Detective Ott said after a few minutes. "Is this still part of campus?"
"Yes, sir. The old house was built a ways from the main campus to give faculty privacy."
Up ahead, the detective saw activity at the end of the narrow path. Spotlights had been set up to brighten the area. And as they approached the end of the dark canopy of forest, it felt like exiting the mouth of a giant prehistoric creature. The officer slowed the cart before they reached the exit.
"Sir, one more thing before we get to the scene."
The detective looked over.
"What is it?"
The officer swallowed.
"It's quite graphic. Worse than anything I've ever seen."
Woken in the middle of the night and stuck somewhere between the buzz he'd fallen asleep with and the hangover that waited, Detective Ott was short on patience and had no flair for the dramatic. He pointed to the edge of the woods.
"Let's go."
The officer drove from the shadows of the path and into the bright halogen spotlights. The crowd here was smaller, less hectic, and more organized. The responding officers had enough sense to keep the horde of police, paramedics, and firefighters to a minimum out here at the crime scene to reduce the chance of contaminating the area. The officer stopped the car just outside the gates of the house.
"Holy Christ," Detective Ott muttered as he stood from the golf cart. All eyes were on him as the first responders watched his reaction and waited for his instruction. In front of him was a large colonial house that looked to come from a century long past. It was cast in the shadowy glow of the spotlights, which highlighted the ivy that crept up the exterior. A wrought iron gate squared off the perimeter of the house, and tall oak trees stretched up into the night. The first body Detective Ott saw was that of a male student, who had been impaled by one of the shafts of the wrought iron gate. Not by accident. Not as though he was trying to scale the gate and had inadvertently fallen onto the tine in the process. No, this was intentional. Almost artful. The young man had been placed there, lifted carefully, then dropped to allow the spear of the gate to rise up into his chin and through his face until it poked through the top of his skull. Detective Ott pulled a small flashlight from his pocket and headed toward the house. That's when he noticed the girl sitting on the ground off to the side. She was covered in blood, with arms wrapped around her knees and rocking back and forth in a detached state of shock.
"This wasn't a couple of kids screwing around. This was a goddamn slaughter."
Part 1. August 2020. Chapter 1. The third episode of the podcast had dropped earlier in the day, and in just 5 hours had been downloaded nearly 300,000 times. In the days to come, millions more would listen to this installment of The Suicide House. Many of those listeners would then flood the internet and social media to discuss their theories and conclusions about the discoveries made during the episode. The chatter would generate more interest, and new listeners would download earlier episodes. Soon, Mac Carter would have the biggest hit in pop culture. This inevitable fact pissed Ryder Hillier off in ways that were indescribable. She had done the research, she had sounded the alarms, and she was the one who had been looking into the Westmont Prep killings for the past year, recording her findings and posting them on her true crime blog. Her YouTube channel had 250,000 subscribers and millions of views. But now all of her hard work was being overshadowed by Mac Carter's podcast. She had seen right away that the Westmont Prep story had legs, that the official version of events was too simple and too convenient, and that the facts presented by law enforcement were selective at best and straight-up misleading at worst. Ryder knew that with the right backing and some smart investigative reporting, the story could draw a huge audience. She had pitched her idea to studios the previous year after the case made national headlines and was open and shut before any real answers were given. But Ryder Hillier was just a lowly journalist, not a bona fide star like Mac Carter. She didn't have the all-American face or the strong vocal cords, and therefore none of the studios had paid any attention to her pitch. She was a 35-year-old journalist unknown outside the state of Indiana. But she was sure her articles about the case, which had run as a feature in the Indianapolis Star and were referenced by several other outlets, as well as the popularity of her YouTube channel, had something to do with a sudden interest in Westmont Prep. Mac Carter didn't shift from primetime television to a podunk town in Indiana by chance. Someone somewhere had been paying attention to her findings, and they saw opportunity and dollar signs. They commissioned Mac Carter, the current host of Events, a nightly news magazine show, to run a superficial investigation and to produce a podcast around his findings. His name would draw attention, and the podcast would draw millions of listeners on the promise that the great Matt Carter, with his proven investigative skills and hard-charging attitude, would find answers to the Westmont Prep killings, which had been too cleanly closed. But in the end, he wouldn't prove a goddamn thing other than that, with the proper sponsorship and tons of upfront cash, a podcast could grow from the ashes of tragedy to become a lucrative endeavor for everyone involved. So long as the tragedy was disturbing and morbid enough to draw an audience, the Westmont Prep killings qualified. Ryder wasn't going to allow the reality of big business to deter her. Quite the contrary. She'd worked too hard to give up now. She planned to piggyback on the success of the podcast. She wanted to pull Matt Carter in, to show him the card she was holding, to gain his interest and make him take notice. Her YouTube channel provided a decent income from advertisers, and her gig at the paper paid the bills. But in her mid-30s, Ryder Hillier wanted more from her career. She wanted to break out, and attaching her name to the most popular true crime podcast in history would bring her to another level. And the truth was, Matt Carter needed her. She knew more than anyone about the Westmont Prep killings, including the detectives who had investigated it. She just needed to figure out how to get Mac's attention. Like hundreds of thousands of others, she had downloaded the latest episode of his podcast. She put the buds into her ears, tapped her phone, and took off down the running trail as Matt Carter's practice voice rang in her ears. Westmont Preparatory High is a well-respected boarding school nestled on the banks of Lake Michigan in the town of Peppermill, Indiana. It prepares teenagers not just for the rigors of college, but for the challenges of life. Westmont Prep has been around for more than 80 years, and its rich history promises that the institution will be here long after those listening to this podcast are gone. But in addition to the honors and accolades, the school has a scar, an ugly, jagged blemish that will also be here for years to come. This podcast is a retelling of the tragedy that occurred at this prestigious school during the summer of 2019, when the rules that normally define the school's conduct were loosened just a bit for those students who remained on campus through the hot summer months. It's the story of a dark and dangerous game gone wrong, of two students brutally murdered, and of a teacher accused. But at its core, this story is also about survivors. A story about the students who are desperately trying to move on, but who have been mysteriously pulled back to a night they can't forget. During this podcast, we will explore the details of that fateful night. We will learn about the victims and about the reckless game that took place in the woods on the edge of campus. We will go inside the abandoned boarding house where the murders took place. We will meet those who survived the attack and take a closer look at life inside the walls of this elite boarding school. We will review police reports, witness interviews, social workers' notes, and psychological evaluations of the students involved. We'll go in depth with the lead detective who ran the investigation. Finally, we'll creep into the mind of Charles Gorman, the Westmont Prep teacher responsible for the killings. Along this journey, I hope to stumble over something new, something no one else has discovered, perhaps a piece of evidence that will shine light on the secret many of us believe is still hidden behind the walls of Westmont Prep. A secret that will explain why students continue to return to that abandoned boarding house to kill themselves. I'm Mac Carter. Welcome to the Suicide House. Ryder shook her head as she jogged. Even the goddamn intro had her hooked. I'm Mac Carter, and on episode 3 of The Suicide House, we're going to meet one of the survivors of the Westmont Prep killings, a student named Theo Compton, who was present at the abandoned boarding house the night of June 21st. Theo, has never before given an interview to the media, but agreed to talk to me exclusively about what happened the night two of his classmates were killed. He reached out to me through the message board on the Suicide House webpage. Per his request, I met him at the McDonald's in Peppermill. We sat at a back booth, where he whispered through most of our discussion. It took a bit of time to get him talking, so I've edited our conversation down to the last third. Here is a recording of the interview, with my comments added in voiceover throughout. So, you were there the night your classmates were killed. Theo nods and scratches its stubble on his cheek.
Yeah, I was there.
Tell me about the abandoned house. What was the draw?
What was the draw? We're a bunch of teenagers trapped at a boarding school with strict rules and a dress code. The house in the woods was an escape.
An escape from what?
From the rules? From the teachers? From the doctors and the counselors and the therapy sessions? It was freedom. We went there to get away from school, to screw off and try to enjoy summer.
You are about to start your senior year at Westmont Prep, correct?
Yeah.
But this current summer, you and your friends don't go out to that house anymore.
No one goes out there anymore.
Last summer, on the night of the killings, you and your friends got caught up in something. A dark and secretive game. Tell me about it. Theo's eyes go mad as his gaze jets to me, then away as he looks out the window and into the parking lot. His reaction gives me the sense that Theo thinks I know more than I do. It's been just over a year since Westmont Prep became infamous for the killings inside its walls, and the students who survived that night are about to start their senior year. The police have refused to answer questions about their investigation, and the silence has fueled the flames of rumor. One of them is that the students were playing a dangerous game the night two of them were killed. Tell me about that night. What were you doing at the house? Theo pulls his gaze from the parking lot and looks at me.
We weren't in the house. We were in the woods.
The woods that surround the house. Theo nods. You were playing a game.
No.
He says this suddenly, as if I've insulted him.
This isn't about the game.
I wait, but he offers no more. So I push. Many have suggested that you and your classmates were participating in a game called The Man in the Mirror, and that it was the commitments and demands of this game that might have brought the horrific events of that night. Theo shakes his head and looks out the window again.
We screwed up, okay? It's time to put the truth out there.
I nod my head and try not to look desperate. The truth. Okay. Tell me what you know. He takes a deep breath. Several of them, in fact, until he is nearly hyperventilating.
We didn't tell the police everything.
About what?
About that night. About a lot of stuff.
Like what? Theo takes a long pause here. I wait anxiously for him to say more. Finally, he does.
Like the things we know about Mr. Gorman.
My breath catches in my throat, and for a moment I can't speak. Charles Gorman is the Westmont Prep teacher accused of murdering Theo Compton's classmates, slaughtering them, in fact, and impaling one of them on a wrought iron fence. The case against him is profound, and there has never been another suspect. But despite the evidence against Gorman, many believe that there is more to the Westmont Prep killings than what the public currently knows. Theo Compton appears ready to produce the missing pieces of a very complicated puzzle.
What about him?
I sound desperate, and Theo recognizes it.
Shit. I can't do this.
Theo shifts his weight and starts to slide out of the booth. Wait. Tell me about Charles Gorman. Do you know why he did it? Theo suddenly stares straight into my eyes.
He didn't.
I fixate unblinkingly on the young man in front of me. I shake my head. Why do you say that? Theo stands up suddenly.
I've gotta go. If the group knew I was talking with you, they'd freak out.
What group? He turns away from the table and is gone in an instant, walking away through the doors of the McDonald's, leaving me alone in the back booth. I sit for a while, asking myself the same question over and over. What group?
Chapter 2. Ryder had made it through half of the episode during her run. She was anxious to finish it, but had an article due the next day. She wrote a weekly true crime column for the Sunday edition of the Indianapolis Star. It was one of the paper's most popular columns, always generating long comment threads for the online edition, and popular news websites commonly linked to it. After a shower, she pulled on jeans and a tank top and sat at her kitchen table, where she opened her laptop. She wrote for an hour, until 10:40 p.m., putting the final touches on an article about a missing South Bend man. There had been some recent developments in the case having to do with the timing of the man's life insurance policy, which brought his wife under suspicion. Ryder was trying her hardest to finish the article, but the writing came slowly, and she was frustrated with her lack of concentration. Mac Carter's deep and practiced voice rattled in her head, and all she wanted to do was get back to the podcast. Finally, she succumbed to her temptation, pushed her laptop aside, and tapped her phone to resume the episode.
So, my interview with Theo Compton was what the kids would call an epic fail. Epic, but not complete. Our short conversation was curious. The Westmont Prep killings happened on June 21st. Charles Gorman came under suspicion after detectives found a manifesto in his home describing in explicit detail how he planned to carry out the murders. In neat, cursive writing, he explained the exact method in which he intended to kill the students, details about slashed jugulars and the particulars of using the tines of the wrought iron gate for impalement. After chronicling his plans in his journal, Gorman did exactly what his words promised. So, Theo Compton has my mind spinning. With so much evidence stacked against Charles Gorman, I'm curious to know if Theo, or any other student, possesses information that might refute this evidence. Of course, if listeners have any leads, I encourage you to head to the message board on the website to share them with me and the rest of the podcast community. For now, let's focus on Gorman and get back to where we left off at the end of last week's episode. I told you that I was granted exclusive access to the Westmont Prep's campus, and in particular to Charles Gorman's house. Now we'll pick up with my tour, which was conducted by the Dean of Students, Dr. Gabriella Hanover. Here is a recording of the interview, with my comments added in voiceover throughout. The Westmont Prep campus is both striking and ominous. The buildings are Gothic structures built from white sandstone and covered by ivy that crawls to the eaves. It's noon on a summer Saturday, and the place is quiet. Only a few students stroll the grounds as Dr. Hanover steers the golf cart over the winding campus paths. The house where the murders took place, is it still off limits? I can immediately tell Dr. Hanover does not like the question. She shoots me a sideways glance that connects with a split second of eye contact. It's as if our fingers touched and sparked with static electricity. The look
is just enough to tell me not to press my luck. She and the school's attorneys explained during the negotiations that preceded this guided tour that the portion of campus where the murders occurred was not only off-limits to me and the podcast, but was inaccessible to the student body as well. That area has been sectioned off by a tall brick wall. I can see the partition in the distance as Dr. Hanover drives me through campus. To curious minds like my own, the red brick does not warn me to stay away. It does just the opposite. It begs me to discover what's beyond it. It shouts to me that it's hiding something sinister. On the other side of that wall are the woods, and in those woods is a forgotten path that leads to the infamous boarding house. For years prior to the killings, the school's plan had been to demolish the house and clear a portion of the forest to make room for a football field, track course, baseball diamond, and soccer field. In just the past few months, the school has secured the funding. Renovation is slated to begin as soon as the Peppermill police determine that there is no more evidence left to gather from the crime scene. Despite the case being so quickly solved, an executive order from the governor has held up the demolition of the house. Last year, he was pressured by the district attorney's office, and they were pressured by the Peppermill Police Department to delay the destruction of the boarding house. Someone inside the department is still convinced that there are unanswered questions about that night hiding in the walls of that house. And so, demolition has been held off. But the powers that be at Westmont Prep, the board of trustees, and those with money tied to the school's success, long for the day the house will meet a wrecking ball. It's a nasty scar on the school's history, and the best way for it to fade is for the house to come down. For now, though, it stands, and I plan to find my way to it. Today, however, I decide to leave my question unanswered rather than press Dr. Hanover on the issue and risk ending the tour. I knew I wouldn't be seeing the abandoned boarding house today, but Gorman's duplex has been promised. And now we are upon it. We approach the faculty housing, a long stretch of connected homes called Teacher's Row. It was here, in number 14, that Gorman lived during his 8-year tenure at Westmont Prep. An exemplary teacher of chemistry, he had only the highest marks of accomplishment and praise on his performance reviews. Reviews that, since the night of June 21st, have come under scrutiny. We pull up to number 14. It's a small, efficient duplex made from burgundy brick and overflowing mortar. Narrow walkways cut between adjacent buildings and are lined by dogwoods and hydrangeas. Dual entrances are present out front, one for number 14, the other for 15. These are pleasant homes, comfortable faculty housing. It's hard to believe such a monster lived here. The keys rattle as the dean unlocks the front door to number 14. We enter to an empty house, but for bits of furniture that have sat unused for the past year. Dr. Hanover leads me through the front room, the kitchen, and a single bedroom. As we pass the small den, Dr. Hanover's phone rings. She excuses herself, stepping outside to take the call. Suddenly, I'm alone in Charles Gorman's home. It's unnervingly quiet. There is something ominous about being here by myself. And I realize there is a likely reason this unit has not been reassigned, and likely never will be. It has sat empty for more than a year, because Gorman lived a secret life inside the walls of this home, and any faculty member who dared to take this place as their own would be walking in a killer's footsteps and dealing with the spirits of the students he killed, spirits that surely roam this empty house looking for closure and answers. I feel them now. I'm looking for the same things they are.
but I shake the chill from my neck. I know I don't have much time. I also know better than to do what I'm contemplating, but my instincts as an investigative reporter are untamed. I walk quickly into the small office. The room is empty. Depression marks on the carpeting show me where a desk once stood in the middle of the room. It is likely the place where Gorman sat when he wrote his manifesto. All that remains in the room now is an empty bookshelf, a chair crooked from the loss of a wheel, and a portrait of the periodic table hanging on the wall. I know what's behind it. I take a quick glance to make sure Dr. Hanover is still outside. Then, I remove the periodic table. Behind it is a safe sunk into the plaster. It was here that detectives discovered Gorman's manifesto. I turn the handle on the safe and pull open the door.
Close that right now.
Dr. Hanover's voice is neither loud nor panicked. It's just direct and firm. I turn from the safe. She's standing in the doorway, and I know I've been made. Eerie music chimed from her phone and pulled Ryder back to the present and away from Charles Gorman's house, where Mac Carter had brought her with his alluring voice and vivid descriptions. The music quieted, and she heard Mac Carter's voice again. On the next episode of The Suicide House, more on my discovery inside Charles Gorman's duplex. You won't want to miss it. Until then, I'm Mac Carter. Chapter 3. An advertisement blared from her phone, and Ryder tapped the screen in frustration to quiet it. She nearly threw the phone across the room. Mac Carter hadn't discovered a goddamn thing in that safe, and Ryder didn't need to wait for the next episode to hear him say it. It was a cheap bait and switch, an embarrassing self-promotion of his abilities as an investigative journalist. Anyone who knew anything at all about the Westmont Prep killings knew that detectives had discovered Gorman's manifesto in the wall safe. There was nothing groundbreaking about Mac Carter's discovery. Yet Ryder was sure that uninformed podcast listeners would be drooling with the idea that Mac had been caught red-handed just as he was about to break the case wide open with the contents of Gorman's safe. She knew the Suicide House website would be overrun with traffic as podcast listeners breathlessly scrolled through the pages to see the photos of the Westmont Prep campus and Charles Gorman's duplex, and to view the cell phone pictures Mac Carter had snapped to the wall safe. Ryder's blog and YouTube channel had much of this information just after the killings. She had obtained the images from newspaper clippings and public records of campus and Teacher's Row. She had even managed to find a picture of the front of Gorman's house roped off by yellow crime scene tape the day after the killings, which had been posted to a student's social media account before being taken down. But Mac Carter's stunt, whispering as he pulled the wall hanging from its hook and hyperventilating as he described the safe behind it, was sure to bring huge numbers to the podcast. She was angry with herself for falling for it, for being as interested as everyone else. She cursed as she scrolled through Mac's website now, having taken the bait like so many others. The message board was already inundated with threads discussing Mac's findings, theories about Theo Compton's cryptic suggestion that Charles Gorman was innocent, and about what Mac might have found inside Gorman's safe. "It's friggin' empty, you know-nothings," Ryder shouted at her computer. "Why would evidence still be present at a crime scene a year after the fact?" After 30 minutes of reading the threads, Ryder could take no more. She was about to click over to her own blog to post some sort of update telling her followers that she was still the fearless real crusader looking for the truth behind the Westmont Prep killings, and that her fans should not abandon her for such a transparent fraud of a podcast. But before she clicked off Mac Carter's site, she saw a video playing on a loop in the comments section. She recognized the footage immediately.
because she had shot it. It was from when she had snuck through the woods behind Westmont Prep a couple of weeks after the killings and captured shaky video of the boarding house. It had been difficult footage to obtain, since back then the area was still roped off with crime scene tape, and the police were interested in keeping prying eyes away from the place. Under the video was a short cryptic comment. MC 1335. Tonight. I'll tell you the truth. Then whatever happens, happens. I'm ready for the consequences. Ryder saw that the comment, which was meant for Matt Carter, had been posted at 10:55 p.m. 30 minutes ago. She grabbed her car keys and dialed her phone as she ran out of the house. Chapter 4. He slowed his car as he passed mile marker 13 and then hit the reset button to bring his odometer to 000. He continued at a reduced speed as he watched the odometer click up from nothing. All the survivors knew the numbers. 13, 3, 5. It was how this whole thing had started. How different things would be had they never heard those numbers, had they never been lured to this place by the promise of adventure and acceptance. But the past could not be changed. He could control only the present in hopes of altering the future. When the number 3 spun up on the odometer, indicating that he'd driven a third of a mile beyond mile marker 13. He pulled over, parked his car on the gravel shoulder, and turned off the headlights. The dark night swallowed the vehicle. He was invisible, and wished he could stay that way. He wished he could don a cloak and hide from the world, from his thoughts, from his memories, from his sins, and from his guilt. But he knew it wasn't that easy. If it were as simple as disappearing, he'd have long ago left this place and all its ghosts behind. How nice it would be to start over somewhere else, maybe at a different school, where he could return to being his old self and leave the past behind. But the demons had hold of him, and running would not cause them to release their grip. Had there been enough miles on this earth to outrun that night, the others would have run and run and run. Instead, they came here. He opened his car door and stepped out from the driver's seat. Walking into the middle of the two-lane road, he looked up into the night sky. Heavy cloud cover had delivered a gray and dismal day, and the coming storm tainted the air with a pungent odor of humidity. The clouds erased the stars, reminding him that he was truly alone in this endeavor. Not even the heavens could look down on him tonight. The quiet of night filled his ears, but he wished for the roar of an 18-wheeler, its tires screaming over the pavement as it approached. How much easier would it be to simply stare into the headlights? He could close his eyes, and it would all be over. Not for the first time, he wondered if the consequences that waited in the afterlife were less than those here on Earth. Finally, he walked from the road and started his journey. Leaving the door wide open, he walked past the front of his car and into the woods. 13, 3, 5. Mile 13, a third of a mile farther, and a half-mile hike through the woods. The path was easy to spot, but the trail through the woods was overgrown since his last trek on it. That had been the previous summer, on the night of the slaughter. And so much had happened since then that he barely recognized his life. He covered the half-mile stretch in 10 minutes and came to the edge of the wooded path where a chain, rusted and corroded, drooped between two posts. A moss-covered placard read, "Private Property," and was a feeble last attempt to keep trespassers away. He walked past the sign, and then the infamous boarding house was in front of him. Before that terrible night had plagued their lives, he and his classmates had come here often, every weekend. Their use of the abandoned building had kept it alive back then. But now, after a year of absolute vacancy, the house was dying. Not like the massacre that took place here, where mortality came quickly and unexpectedly. No, the house was experiencing a slower death, one day at a time. The bricks were crumbling, and the cedar around the doors and windows was warped. The eaves had rotted, and gutters poked like hangnails from the roofline. The place looked ghostly in the dark of night, with frayed yellow crime scene tape still secured to the gate and flapping in the night breeze. He hadn't been back since that night, when he and the others had come to show the police what exactly had transpired, as much as they were willing to tell, anyway. He stepped into the clearing and walked toward the house. Its wrought iron gate was like a moat surrounding a castle, rusted and decrepit. The hinges whined into the night when he pushed the gate open, the bottom of the tines clawing half circles into the mud. His mind flashed back to what this gate had looked like the night of the killings. He blinked his eyes, but the image stayed firm in his vision. His thoughts stuck on the images of that night, blood and gore. He thought of the secrets they had kept, the things they had hidden. His mind became dizzy with it all, until the rumble of the freight train pulled him back to the present. He shook his head to gain his bearings, then hurried along the side of the house to where the path bent and led to the tracks. The decisions they all had made that night brought him to this spot, the same spot where Mr. Gorman had come. And it was here that the rest of his existence would start. It was here that he would face down his demons and finally be free. The train's whistle filled the night as the locomotive approached. Together with the thundering of the train cars on the rails, he could hear nothing else. As he waited next to the tracks, he sunk his hands into his pockets and grasped the item that was there. Like a child sucking on a pacifier, the feel of it between his fingertips provided a calming sensation. It always had. As the train approached, with its headlamp like a beacon in the night, he didn't attempt to shield his ears from the thunderous roar. He wanted to hear the train. He wanted to feel it and smell it and taste it. He wanted the train to carry his demons away. He closed his eyes. The thunder was deafening. Chapter 5. Mac Carter sat in his rented house in Peppermill, Indiana, popped open a beer, and read through his notes one last time. He took a sip to wet his throat, adjusted his noise-canceling headphones, pulled the microphone close to his lips, and spoke. The Westmont Prep killings left the nation saddened and stunned that such a terrible tragedy could take place inside the protected sanctuary of a private boarding school. So far, we've taken a look at some of the details of that fateful night. During the next episode, we will learn more about the two students who were killed, and we will take a deep dive into the dangerous game they were playing. To do this, we will take a closer look at what life was like inside this elite boarding school, and we will examine the teenagers that made up the student body. As always, I hope to stumble over something new along the way, something no one else has discovered, a secret many of us believe is still hidden inside the walls of Westmont Prep. I'm Mac Carter, and this is the Suicide House. Mac tapped the laptop's touchscreen to stop recording. He played the promo back as he finished his beer, tweaking segments of it and working on the timing of the delivery and the cadence of his voice. When he was satisfied, he emailed the intro to his producer. Already, his was the most downloaded podcast of the season. The Westmont Prep case was wildly popular within the true crime community, and the story still had legs in the mainstream media. His network, where his popular nightly news magazine show ran five nights a week, was backing the production, and the huge sponsorship deals they had signed were a good predictor of success. The Suicide House was the next big thing. He spent an hour in the small recording studio his network had built in the rental house in Peppermill. On the computer in front of him were all the recordings he had created over the past week. His producer had cleaned them up and trimmed them down, and now they waited for Mac's review and approval before his team would start organizing them into a coherent episode. Many of the sound bites were red flagged, indicating additional voiceover work was needed from Mac. He popped another beer and worked steadily until 11:30 p.m. when his phone rang. He didn't recognize the number, but he'd been getting many random calls since his arrival in Peppermill. Most of his interviews to this point had been conducted over his phone, which was fastened with a recording device that captured not only Mac's voice, but the caller's as well. When played back on the podcast, the audio was surprisingly clear. He activated the recorder as he answered the call. Mac Carter. It's Ryder Hillier. Mac closed his eyes. He almost stopped recording. Ryder Hillier was a true crime journalist who ran a popular blog that hosted forums and chat rooms where other nuts shared conspiracy theories about all sorts of cases from around the country, from missing persons to homicides. The Westmont Prep killings had been one of Ryder's most popular cases. She had researched and written about it extensively over the past year, and she'd been reaching out to Mac since word broke about him hosting the podcast. Listen, Ryder, I don't have time right now.
Have you been reading the threads on your website?
I'm right in the middle of something, Ryder.
Of course not. You probably have a slew of assistants who do that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.